Well, you hear the same things over and over and over again from what I'm calling the usual suspects, you know, CNN, MSNBC, all of the major networks, the New York Times and others. And nobody seems to be telling the story, at least the way that I'm viewing it. Now, I'm hoping the folks that are listening are aligned with sort of the way that I'm viewing things and they understand at least where I'm coming from. And maybe they feel sort of the same way about it. And, you know, certainly if you have something to say about this impeachment witch hunt, please feel free to give us a call at 888-404-1010 because we'd love to hear from you. But, you know, there's a few things that come to mind about the impeachment. And that is, I don't know if you got a chance to watch most of the proceedings, the Star Chamber proceedings. And then they switched, remember, and they had the public proceedings. And the Star Chamber proceedings were largely secret. We don't even have all those transcripts, and apparently not all of those transcripts came out so favorably, and so they were selectively leaked from the basement proceedings, the secret proceedings that Adam Schiff was conducting for a certain period of time. He selectively leaked certain things, and it's a lot of innuendo that he leaked.
Why aren't they putting him up to ask questions?
Well, they want to do that.
Yeah,
Republicans want to do that. And, you know, if you think back to the Bill Clinton impeachment, you know, Ken Starr, who was the lead prosecutor in that, it was the special counsel in that, or independent counsel is what they called him at that time. You know, he actually testified about it and about his investigation and what his findings were. Now, Adam Schiff has even said that he is acting like a special prosecutor in this case. But he doesn't want to come testify. And if you listen to some of the things he said, you know, you'll know if the Republicans are taking this seriously by whether or not they try to ask me to testify. And if they try to ask me to testify, they're not taking anything seriously. Well, that just doesn't match the model of the previous impeachment. And more importantly, I think, is what happened before the alleged whistleblower, and he's not a whistleblower, he's a weaponized leaker. What happened before he filled out that whistleblower form? Now, there's been a lot said about what kind of protections the whistleblower gets, and I think it's been generally overstated by the Democrats in Congress. They say things like he's entitled to anonymity from all sources. That's just not true. He's entitled to anonymity from the Inspector General for the Intelligence Community, but he's not entitled to anonymity if he gets discovered by other means. And certainly even the New York Times has given out enough details that people were able to identify who the whistleblower is. And he's been named repeatedly. Although you've got major news organizations, you've got Facebook and others who are blocking content that actually names the whistleblower. Now, we don't know for sure that he's the guy, but certainly nothing has come out to prove that it's anybody else or to disprove that it's this guy, Cherumella, that they've talked about and has been named on Fox News and was first, I think, publicly named in widespread accounts by Real Clear Politics and the very fine reporter Paul Sperry, who used to be with Investors Business Daily. You know, he's done an excellent job in his investigations, Real Clear Investigations. And he does excellent reporting, and he's the one who first sort of publicly named who the alleged whistleblower is. Now, again, we don't have confirmation, but of course, Paul Sperry didn't stop there. He went back and actually looked at this guy's social media accounts and saw that shortly after the whistleblower complaint was filed, things started being pulled out of the social media accounts to sort of make this guy a little bit of a ghost on the internet so that you wouldn't be able to discover all that much information about him. Now, to my way of thinking, isn't he a crucial witness? I mean, don't you have the right under the Sixth Amendment to confront your accusers? I mean, he's the primary accuser. But more importantly, the things that we've seen have totally eviscerated his complaint. I mean, he was making a complaint based on second or third hand information, which we think he got from that guy, Lieutenant Colonel Venman, you know, the guy who refused to be called Mr. Venman, the military officer who never wears his military uniform except when he comes to testify in Congress. And then when Congressman Nunes says, Mr. Venman, which I don't think he meant intentionally as an insult or anything. I think he was just speaking as a matter of course. He says, Mr. Venman. And the guy says, ranking member, it's Lieutenant Colonel Venman. You know, I mean, what a jerk. I mean, do you know the fact that the civil government controls the military in our country? The military is not in charge. They are not in charge of the civilian government. They don't get to tell the civilian leadership what to do. Now, granted, I believe in giving respect to people, and he certainly is deserving of respect, but there, if you watch that clip, in my opinion, there was absolutely no disrespect meant in that way by Devin Nunes. And if you read a book, which I've been reading, I got about halfway through it over the break, and that's The Plot Against the President. This is a fascinating book. It was written by Lee Smith. And if you're interested in this stuff, I mean, the granular detail of it, I recommend you go out and get this book and read it, because what you'll learn is this plot that's been going on the entire time President Trump has been president, and started even before he was president with the insurance policy, remember, that was discussed in Andy's office. This is basically a plot cooked up by a very small group of people within our intelligence community, including FBI and CIA folks. Mainly, though, it looks like the FBI was the one that was most heavily involved under James Comey and Andrew McCabe. And these guys cooked up a plot to try to take down a president. Now, this was also run out of the White House. The president, Obama, apparently wanted to know everything that was going on and actually tried to set the incoming administration, President Trump's administration, up for failure when they took over, which is pretty offensive. I mean, we really look. I remember when, you know, Bill Clinton left office and they took all the W's out of the keyboards, if you remember that, because President George W. Bush was coming in. So as an insult, they removed all the little W keys out of the keyboards. OK. All right. So that is just being a jerk. That's just being childish. But OK, they did that. But that doesn't go anywhere near the extent of what we saw President Obama try to do to the incoming administration of President Trump.
They took the T's, the R's, the U. They took all.
Well, no, they set them up with a soft coup. It began
they
with this whole.
They put glue on the T, the R, the U, and it just made a big mess. Yeah.
You know, one of the things that, you know, is meaningful to me is you look into the whistleblower's attorney. Now, that's a fact we do know. That's a guy named Mark Zaid. And we've talked about him before on this show and some of his crazy tweets. But I want to read to you a tweet from January 30th of 2017 from his account. And this is still up because I've retweeted it recently. So you can find this still in his feed. And he is retweeting Jake Tapper saying that the president had just fired Acting Attorney General Sally Yates for refusing to enforce a legal order designed to protect the citizens of the U.S. Remember the travel ban? Remember what a big deal that was at the beginning? And she said she would not enforce the order. I mean, the insubordination from these people is just shocking. And they expect to be able to keep their jobs when they're insubordinate like that? I mean, who do you think is the president now? Well, obviously, they don't think that the Trump administration is legitimate, and they'll do anything they have to do to undermine it. But let me read you Mark Zaid's tweet. He says, January 30th of 2017, this is the lawyer for the whistleblower, he says, hashtag, see, I'm showing my age now, hashtag coup has started. First of many steps. Hashtag rebellion. Hashtag impeachment will follow ultimately. Hashtag lawyers. That last one there just kind of makes me laugh. Hashtag lawyers. Watch out for the lawyers. But, you know, listen to him. The coup has started. It's the first of many steps. This is a rebellion. The impeachment will follow ultimately. So they've been planning for this whole thing since the very first day, since the very moment President Trump assumed office. They've been working on this coup plot.
Makes me sick to my stomach to hear that.
And why don't we have this whistleblower brought in and ask a few questions? And also, when did you contact Congressman Schiff's office? Because, you know, it's been disclosed, and he even changed the form after he signed it and filed it because he lied on it initially and said he didn't have any contact with anybody ahead of time. He then had to go back and amend the form to acknowledge that he did have contact with Congressman Schiff's office before filing the form. But he said, but it was non-substantive contact. Oh, I'm sure. It was non-substantive. You know what? They probably didn't even talk about it. They're probably talking about their grandkids, right? You know, just like Bill Clinton and Loretta Lynch on the tarmac, right? I mean, they were talking about nothing, right? It wasn't anything important. Are you silly? Are you crazy?
Thank you for listening to the Morgan Streetman Show. We hope you enjoyed what you heard. And if you did, please click like and subscribe to help us out. And remember that we recommend that you exercise your brain at least once a week.